1, 2, 1, 2.
All right, we're here at Terry Hoage Winery. You guys, did you move here because of this little lake you've got right here? Is this how you found the property?
No, it's actually been a process. We moved to Paso, I guess in 2000, a few years after I retired playing football. I used to play for the Cardinals. It was my last team. And we had two kids, and we wanted to bring our kids up in an agrarian community. You know, we moved here not knowing what we were going to do. And Jennifer actually commuted back and forth to Phoenix for 2 years, supporting us, running her business in Phoenix.
You miss football?
Not at all. Physically, this is a little bit easier.
Right.
But, you know, I've never worked harder doing this, but I absolutely enjoy it. And luckily, you know, I have Jennifer. My goal is to go through life and never have a job.
So, yeah. Sounds like you're not doing too good at that. Sounds like a lot of work.
It's a lot of work, but it's not a job. Yeah, I mean, yeah. You know.
When you're passionate about something, it doesn't feel like work. Yeah. So.
I enjoy farming. I enjoy being outside. You know, I tried a bunch of different things when I got, or while I was playing, kind of preparing for my life after football, and then, you know, when I got done playing football, the one thing that I discovered early on was I have to be outside. Jennifer and I live on property, and we get to experience kind of all that stuff that people get to experience just as they come through for a few minutes. But it really is what Jennifer and I do for a living.
It is neat, and you see people get out of their car and they're just breathtaking by the, you know, views, and they get out and the first thing they want is a photograph. And it's a nice feeling.
So the barns came from three historic barns in Iowa. They were actually tearing down barns and destroying them. In burning the wood.
Right.
I have relatives in the area that offered to go in ahead of the destruction crews and tear off all the siding. So that's all wood that was hand-hewn 100, 150 years ago and hung on the outside of agricultural barns in the Midwest.
Right.
So this is my fishing pond. And it's got big.
So you stocked it once, I think I heard, and then yeah. it's flourished ever since?
Yeah, it's obviously a pretty healthy ecosystem. I mean, we draw in ducks, we have mallards, and we stocked it with, bait fish and catfish and bass. And, you know, now we've got an ecosystem that goes from very small bass to very large bass. You know, all of the plants around the outside are volunteer. All of the lily pads are volunteer. All of the plants in the water volunteer. I mean, the only thing that wasn't volunteer was the fish that we stocked it with. And you know, everything has been brought in by.
But it's self-sustaining.
Right. Yeah. In the dog's better days, did he ever jump in?
Oh yeah. Yeah. We used to have a cormorant that would fly in from the coast. We're about 15 miles, I guess, as a bird flies as a cormorant flies from the coast. So he would come over and like hang out and eat my fish. And so the dogs would just go nuts. I mean, one of the great things about making wine in Paso Robles, making wine and growing grapes and fruit here, is the consistency of weather. In the summer, we have these beautiful, warm days, and then at night, the sun goes down, the temperature drops. So in Paso, you have the ability to kind of craft the wines that you want to make. It lends a lot of tools to the winemaker. The wines coming out of here have been elevated in quality, and people are really making wines that stand up against anybody.
A lot of new people coming from Napa now, which is kind of neat.
Yeah, right. I'm proud to have kind of participated in this upswell of quality from the region, and having people search, us as well as other winemakers out, and it's humbling and exciting.
Right.